Let's take a closer look at types in programming languages. So why do we need types? So the first thing we said was that the storage in a computer is all binary. We only have binary digits, zeros and ones. So everything is a bit sequence. So there is no way of really recording the meaningful value there except by interpreting it through a type. So we have to decide whether this part of the memory should represent an integer or a float, what type of operations are allowed on it, and so on. So just to convert this kind of uniform storage of bits into some meaningful concepts that we can use externally, we need to impose some notion of types. But the other part which is also useful is that by associating meaningful types with values, we can more carefully record what our intent is when we are programming. So we are programming at a level where we are dealing with some abstract concepts, and we want to reflect those concepts in the types that we are using. So for instance, if we are using a kind of geometric kind of application where we are dealing with points and so on, even though a point is just at a very concrete level a pair of floats, we might want to create an abstract notion of point as a type so that we can keep track of those variables which represent points and be able to read them off more clearly in our code. And of course, if we have a more complicated application, something like a banking application, we might have higher order types, I mean types which are more complex in nature. So we might want a type to record a bank account, and we might want to record customer as a different type, and so on. So we will come back to this in this class. And the third thing that we mentioned earlier also, and we want to emphasize, is the role of types in finding errors. So if your code is statically typed, then even when you're reading it, you can look for errors in typing. And if it's dynamically typed, then you do it when you're running it. But in any case, type errors are a bit like dimension errors when you're doing, say, a calculation in physics. So supposing you want to know whether, So supposing you want to know whether velocity is actually acceleration times time, then you can say that the dimension of acceleration is meters per second squared and time is second. So then if I cancel, I will get meters per second, which is a correct dimension of velocity. Whereas it cannot be acceleration times time squared, because then the 2 seconds will cancel out, you'll have only meters. So this is a kind of sanity check that you can do in a physics equation to check that the quantities that you're multiplying actually go together to produce the quantity that you want. And in a similar way, type checking does that. So let's look at the first part of it, which is associating a meaningful value with a bit sequence. So when I have a variable x in my program, I want to know, is it an int or a float or a scar or whatever it is, right? So how does the program determine this? How does the programming language indicate what kind of type we are working with? So in Python, this is done through the value which is associated with that variable, right? So Python uses what is called dynamic typing. So a name x does not in itself convey any type in Python until it has a value. So when we assign, for instance, x equal to 10, then at this point x becomes a value of type int. So x on its own does not have any type, it's the value which is stored in x which determines its type. So Python allows us to take the same x and later on change its value to 7.5. And in this process, the type of x changes. So notice that x doesn't have a fixed type, right? X's type depends on the value that it has. And in particular, when we start, the first time we see an x in our program, if it doesn't have any value associated with it, it has no type. So an uninitialized name in Python has no type, and this has a consequence, as we will see. So what is the option? Well, the other option is to announce to the programming language what type each variable is. So this is what is done in languages like Java, which we will see, and C++ and other things. So you take a name and you associate a type with it up front. So you declare, as it's called. So they're variable declaration. So you have things like int x. This says x is a variable I'm going to use, and I'm going to use it always as type integer. So notice the always. So now, unlike in the earlier case, you cannot take this int x and convert it to 7.5, because that is no longer valid, right? So similarly, you can say for any type, you can say a is of type float and so on. So the main point is that this is now static. Static in the sense that the type of a value of a variable is fixed once and for all through its declaration, and you cannot change it just by assigning a different value to it. In fact, you are not allowed to ideally assign non-compatible values given the type of the variable. So when people argue about which programming language is easiest to learn, so one of the arguments made in favor of Python is that it's very convenient because you don't have to do all this bureaucracy of declaring variables in advance. Now this is indeed true, it does cut down the syntax of the language and make it easier to approach for a new programmer, because you don't have all these mysterious headings int x and float a before you start doing anything meaningful by way of computation. But it's not necessarily a great thing to have this feature in your programming language. So let's look at an example. So the first is, what happens when you make a mistake by just accidentally mistyping a variable? So here is a trivial function which computes the list of factors of a given number n. So it starts with an empty list, factor list, and it runs through all the numbers from 1 to n. So remember that range goes 1 less, so n plus 1 for n. So it goes from 1 to n, and wherever you find a factor, something which divides n without leaving a remainder, you add it to the factor list. Now all well and good, except there is a problem, and that is that in this update to factor list, we have unintentionally written factor list without an I on the left. So there is a typo. Now this may be something which you catch or don't catch when you're reading it, but the point is Python will not complain about this at all, because this is a perfectly valid Python program. It doesn't do what you intend, and it might take you a long time to figure out why it is doing something wrong. But essentially what's happening is that each time you come here, factor list remains empty because you have never really updated it. You take the latest factor and you assign factor LST, the spurious variable, to be the latest factor you have found as a singleton list. So at the end of this, this will basically have the largest factor, namely n. So this particular thing will always end up with this as the return value. Okay. Now, this problem is there because Python has no way of knowing when you use a variable for the first time, whether it's a new variable or an old variable or not, because you have not declared it. And its type, remember, is inherited in some sense from the value it is associated with. So that's really the problem, that, you know, if you don't announce in advance, you cannot catch errors like this, right? So that is an error. The other problem with this dynamic typing is the fact that you don't have a type if you don't have a value. Now, in most situations, you would not want this. I mean, there's no reason why you want to use an uninitialized integer or an uninitialized float anywhere. But if you have more complex things like these abstract data types like linked lists, right? So remember that in a linked list, we typically have a sequence of these nodes, right? And then we have our variable of, say, L pointing to this sequence of nodes. So these are all nodes. Now, if I could tell you in advance that L is of type list, so this is a declaration which we don't have in Python, then I could meaningfully assign L to be the value none to denote the empty list. But this is not possible in Python because I don't have this. So now in Python, if I say L is equal to none, then L has no type, because none has no type. So I am forced to actually use some kind of a dummy node and make L point to it and have some convention by which I say a node in which, say, the value is none denotes an empty list. So I have to really create, and if you want to think about it, I have to create a non-empty list with some special property to denote an empty list. And this becomes very clunky to program with if you are used to programming it in a statically typed language, where you can define the type and then associate a none or a nil value with that variable. So the second utility of using types, we said, was to align the program more closely to the concepts that we are trying to express. So this is an example we looked at the beginning of today's lecture. So we said if you are dealing with geometric objects like types, you might have two-dimensional points, three-dimensional points. So a two-dimensional point is just a pair of floats. A three-dimensional point is just a triple of floats. But if you think about them as new types, 0.2D and 0.3D, it becomes clearer to you as you're reading it which variables are doing what. And for the reader of the program or the maintainer of the program, also it's easier. So here we are really using some kind of a synonym. We are not creating a new type as such. Okay, it's not like a stack with pop or push. It's just saying that we are renaming a particular thing, a pair of floats, to be point 2D. So when I read point 2D, it's more clear what the intent is than to read pair of floats. So this is just from a readability perspective. But as we know, we have also more complicated scenarios which we want, where we want to create these more complicated types with designated operations. So we have typically looked at things like stacks and queues and priority queues and so on, but there is nothing to prevent this from being at an arbitrary level of sophistication. So imagine that you are writing a large banking application. So within the banking world, there are some well-defined entities which you have to typically manipulate. So there will be bank accounts, of course, there will be customers, and then the types of operations that you do will also be classified into different things. There will be deposits, there will be withdrawals, there will be transfers, and each of them carries some data, right? When I do a transfer, a transfer will consist of several things. It will consist of the time of the transfer, the account from the transfer to which it is transferred, the amount of the transfer, and so on. Even maybe the currency of the transfer. So these are all things which have their own associated data and possibly operations associated with it. So if you could create in this abstract data type world, higher level types denoting these different objects differently, so you can have accounts and you can have customers which don't behave the same. So if you want to do withdrawals and deposits and so on, you cannot apply it to a customer, but of course you could apply it to an account. Similarly, if you want to update, say, the KYC details of a customer, you could apply it to a customer object, but not to an account object. So in this way, by having types which reflect the ground truth of what you're trying to manipulate in a more direct way, you can make your program easier to maintain and also guarantee correctness to make sure that you're not doing the wrong thing with the wrong object. So this brings us to the idea of doing wrong things. So one thing that static typing allows us to do is to do what's called static analysis. By just reading the code, the compiler is able to actually detect errors early. Now in anything that we do, the earlier we detect an error, the better it is. I mean, whether it's constructing a building or whether it is writing a program, if you find out the fault after the program is built or the building is built, then it's much more difficult to break it down and then to redo the thing than to find out right at the beginning there's something flawed with the design. So in every case, early detection of errors saves cost in real cost and also effort and time. Now the reason this is important is because there is a fundamental limitation of programs, which is that programs cannot check themselves. So this is the content of Alan Turing's famous result concerning the impossibility of the halting problem. So remember that we have compilers, right? So we have compilers, right, which take a program and produce a program. So we do have programs which read other programs and they can do something meaningful. A compiler can check that the input program is syntactically correct, and if it is correct, it can translate it into another language, the machine language, right? So now what I want to do is write a program, right, which will take as input another program and some value that is input to that program. So I want to simulate P on X and I want to ask, does P return a value? So this is not even asking whether P does the correct thing on X. It's just asking whether P produces some output on X. Does it halt? Right? Hence the halting problem. Or does it just go into an infinite loop and not come out at all? Now this looks like something that should be doable. If we can compile a program and decide whether it's correct and then finally we can even interpret it and run it, why can't we examine it and figure out whether or not it will at least terminate on a given input? But what Alan Turing proved was this is not possible. It's not possible to write such a kind of higher level object than a compiler which can actually analyze arbitrary programs and decide whether their behavior is valid or not valid. So given that we cannot do this in general, so we cannot hope to check programs even for something as basic as halting, forget about correctness, we need to provide as many mechanisms as possible to make sure that we don't make mistakes. And one of the easiest things to fix is this type error, right? So that's why we use typing. So with variable declarations, and if we have static typing, a compiler can easily detect whether there are such errors, right? Now we can also do this with dynamic typing. So Python obviously finds errors as it runs, but then you can see that Python is actually monitoring these errors as they come. So some of the errors that Python finds are runtime errors, right? You're trying to divide by zero or something. But if it's a type mismatch, like you're trying to combine a list and an integer into a new list, then this kind of error can be caught much easier at statically at compile time. Even before your program runs, a compiler can say this is not going to work, right? So when you do it dynamically, you incur an overhead because you have to monitor these errors as you're running, whereas many of these errors can actually be caught in advance if you do static typing. The other thing which we will not address much is that you can also do some optimization. So a compiler can now take a look at some of the code and do some, it can, for example, check that certain values are used somewhere else and compute an intermediate thing. It can figure out some relationships between parts of objects and so on. So we won't get into this, but this also is one of the features of having a good typing mechanism. So to summarize, what we have seen is that there are at least three different ways in which typing helps us program. The first is absolutely essential, which is that we need to make sense out of this bit world that we live in. Right? So the computer stores everything as sequences of bits, and if we did not impose a certain type discipline on top of these storage objects, we would not be able to say that this is an integer and that is a float, because internally everything looks the same to the computer. Right? So if I take a sequence, I could interpret it whichever way you tell me to, and then it makes a different value. So the way I represent 0 may or may not be the same as an int as a float. Right? The other thing is that we can use these types to make our programs more transparent, in the sense that we can create types which reflect the concepts we are manipulating. So we saw examples of points in a geometric program or bank accounts and customers and so on. And finally, typing helps compilers detect errors at an early stage, which is always a good thing. Now, one thing which we should not assume is that, so we mentioned that in a statically typed language like C or Java, usually you declare the types and only then you get to know the types. Now it is actually not true that you need to declare types if you have a statically typed language. So you can also, if you know that the types are static, so in Python the problem is the types are not static, right? So we saw that you can say x equal to 10 and then you can say x equal to 7.5. So there is no consistency of the type of x, it depends on the value that is stored. But supposing I tell you that every variable has a fixed type and this type should be uniform across the thing, then I can start inferring the type based on the context. For instance, if I see something like x equal to 7 somewhere in my program, this tells me that x in this context is certainly an integer because it's assigned an integer value. So let me assume that everywhere it's an integer. Now somewhere if I find out that it's not an integer, then there is an error and I can flag it. Similarly, if I see something like y equal to x plus 15 and I have already deduced that x is an integer, I can also deduce that y is an integer. So I can make these deductions, and this is called type inference. I'm inferring the type from the context in which it is used. And if this inference is consistent, that is, if I can consistently assign a type to every variable, then I don't need the programmer to tell me the types. So this is very interesting, and this is there in many languages. It's not there in Java, but this is also there. So static typing is important, but type declarations are not always required for static typing if you have a more sophisticated way of inferring types. But in our context, static typing goes hand in hand with declaring variables.